still, for the presence of the Lord, the Holy One, is here. Come bow before Him now with reverence and fear. In Him all sin is found. We stand on holy ground. Be still, for the presence of the Lord, the Holy One, is here.
Let's just spend a moment to be still and to recognize God's presence with us. As we think of all the things that are going on in our world, maybe the things that are going on in our own communities, in our families, in our own lives, that are in danger of stealing God's peace from us. Let's just come to that place where Jesus calms the storm, where Jesus gathers us under His wings, where we can feel the beat of His heart, and where we can know His love, His protection, and His saving power. Father God, we thank You that You sent Jesus to be the Prince of Peace. And we pray that You will set that peace in our hearts. And as we receive that precious gift, that blessing of peace, help us to receive more as we gather together this morning, as we learn more of your kingdom, as we learn more of all that you have done for us. Lord, just help us to receive from you and from one another. So as we gather, we say, come Holy Spirit, come Dove of Peace, come fill our hearts, come fill our lives. And Lord, help that peace to overflow from us into the troubles of our world. So come, Lord, we pray, as we worship you. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. The Lord be with you. Welcome to our service this morning. Just one notice before we start. We did have PCC on Thursday, and in line with maybe the rest of the world, we've kind of decided to maybe ease our restrictions a little bit at church. So the idea is, I mean, if you feel happy not wearing a mask, then we're just kind of leaving that decision up to you, but being very mindful that the infection rate of COVID is still rising as restrictions have been eased, which I suppose is sort of common sense. It was would happen. We are having coffee after the service, but again, I would just ask you to perhaps not mix with too many people and to be mindful of perhaps those that are a little bit more anxious and who may want to keep socially distance and may want to keep wearing their masks. Let's just respect and love one another and allow each other to do what we need to do. I do still think it's important for us to continue to pray for Ukraine. And I want to just share a couple of verses from Psalm 31. And I would encourage you maybe to read the whole of that psalm on a regular basis over the next few days and weeks. It's a psalm that the chief rabbi in Ukraine has suggested that people of faith might read. And it's a prayer that the people of Ukraine are reading together too. And then I'll say the prayer that we've been given by the archbishops to pray for the Ukraine. So Psalm 31, beginning at verse 21 to 24. Praise be to the Lord, for he has shown me the wonders of his love. When I was in a city under siege, in my alarm I said, I am cut off from your sight. Yet you heard my cry for mercy when I called to you for help. Love the Lord, all his faithful people. The Lord preserves those who are true to him, but the proud he pays back in full. Be strong and take heart, all you who hope in the Lord. And so let us pray. God of peace and justice, we pray for the people of Ukraine today. We pray for peace and the laying down of weapons. We pray for those who fear for tomorrow, that your spirit of comfort would draw near to them. We pray for those with power over war or peace, for wisdom, discernment, and compassion to guide their decisions. Above all, we pray for all your precious children at risk and in fear, that you would hold and protect them. We pray in the name of Jesus, the Prince of Peace. Amen. We continue. Lord, you are our light and our salvation, our hope in times of fear. You protect us at times of danger, and you hear our prayers. So, Lord, we seek your face and we trust in your goodness. Amen. We're going to stand to sing our first song as we just ask for God's guidance as we travel and journey through this life. Let's stand together. Please do sit down. Perhaps one thing that is in danger of stealing our peace is that sense of guilt when we make those wrong choices, when we don't love God and others as we are meant to do. But we know that we can come to the God of love, the God who wants us to know his peace. And he will forgive us and give us each a fresh start. And so we come in confidence. The sacrifice of God is a broken spirit, a broken and contrite heart God will not despise. Let us come to the Lord, who is full of compassion, and let's acknowledge our transgressions in penitence and in faith. Let's just pause for a time to reflect on our words, on our actions, and our attitudes. Dear God, forgive us when the words we speak expose our self-interest. Help us, forgive us, and deepen our faith. Forgive us when the things we do compromise your integrity. Help us, forgive us, and deepen our faith. Forgive us when the way we use our resources clashes with your core values. Help us, forgive us, and deepen our faith. For Christ's sake, amen. And so let's receive that precious gift of forgiveness. As a hen covers her chicks with her wings, so you cover us with your forgiving love, drawing us into a new beginning, a new way of being, a new way of serving, strengthening, sustaining, and surrounding us with your power and your presence each day of our lives and beyond. Amen. Please would you stand with me as we affirm our faith and the faith of the church together. Let us affirm our faith in Jesus Christ, the Son of God. Though he was divine, he did not cling to equality with God, but made himself nothing. Taking the form of a slave, he was born in human likeness. He humbled himself and was obedient to death, even the death of the cross. Therefore, God has raised him on high and given him the name above every name, that at the name of Jesus, every knee would bow and every voice proclaim that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. Amen. And we come to the throne of that God now, as we sing together before the throne of God above. Just as we remain standing, we pray. Almighty God, by the prayer and discipline of Lent, may we enter into the mystery of Christ's sufferings, and by following in his way, come to share in his glory, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Please do sit down for our reading from Luke's Gospel. Kieran, are you going to come and read for us?
A reading from Luke 13:31. At that time, some Pharisees came to Jesus and said to him, "Leave this place and go somewhere else. Herod wants to kill you." He replied, "Go and tell that fox. I will keep on driving out demons and healing people today and tomorrow. On the third day, I will reach my goal. In any case, I must press on today, tomorrow, and the third day, for surely no prophet can die outside Jerusalem. Jerusalem, Jerusalem, you who kill the prophets and stone those sent to you, how often I have longed to gather your children together as a hen gathers her chicks under her wings, and you were not willing. Look, your house is left to you desolate. I tell you, you will not see me again until you say, 'Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord.'" This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Let's just pause to pray. Lord, as we journey through Lent with these familiar Lenten readings, Lord, we just pray that you will open our eyes and our hearts to learn a new truth, maybe deepen our faith in what we already know. Lord, just help us to move along that road to Jerusalem with you and for you. And we pray in your name. Amen. I'm sure we've all used those figures of speech which compare one thing with another thing that's completely different to give a really colourful description. I'm sure Holly there, well, at school, learned about similes, weren't you, Holly? And that's kind of what I remember at school, when we kind of compared one thing to another and we came up with all sorts of different comparisons to try and make our writing more exciting. So we might speak of a person being as proud as a peacock, or as wise as an owl, or as slippery as an eel. One of the things that I don't quite understand is the one that says something about they were as sick as a dog. Don't kind of get that, but anyway, we do say it, but for one reason or another. But those phrases usually give us an idea of what someone or something is like. And this way of describing things is not a new thing. Indeed, there are those examples found in the very word of God. Jesus himself is spoken about as the Lion of Judah. Was he a lion? Not physically, but it describes his might and his power and his kingship over all. He's also known as the Lamb, pointing to his sacrifice. And in our reading today, we see Jesus referring to himself like a mother hen, sheltering her chicks under her wings, in that relation, in that desire to want to gather people to himself, to protect them from the consequences of evil and judgment that was to come. And we might think that this is an obscure picture, and it kind of is, because it's something that Jesus does not say that gives it its fuller meaning. We have to read between the lines, so to speak. You see, Jesus' words are related to the effects of a fire, but he never mentions the word fire directly. And I'm sure fire is something that we can relate to in some way. We've all seen the pictures of the devastated moorland fires. We've seen those fires in Australia that have completely wiped out areas and regions. We've seen people running for their lives and their livelihoods. In the last few weeks, we've heard of a fire in a school in Halifax. There's been a fire in the mill in Keighley. And we know that fire destroys all that stands in its way. And moreover, fire was an ever-present danger in the ancient world, where it was a necessary part of everyday life, for heating, for cooking, and for industry. But with none of today's precautions or firefighting equipment, and with crowded streets and tenement houses, fire could be an ever-present danger. And if it got out of hand, it could spread quickly out of control. And although Jesus was giving a nod to the devastating nature of fire in general, he was not painting a picture of a fire in a city, but a farmyard. He was referring to the way that animals have instincts which come into play in the event of fire. Some, of course, will run and try and escape, but others have developed ways of at least protecting their young. And one of those ways is when the mother hen gathers her chicks under her wings to protect them from the danger. And I understand that hens are known for being ultra-maternal, and so they'll also gather other small animals, possibly kittens or ducks, under their wings for protection too. And it's commonplace after such a fire to find a mother hen being killed by the fire, but under her wings, her chicks are alive and well because they have survived the blaze because of their mother's sacrifice for them. This is indeed a graphic picture of what Jesus desired to do for Jerusalem as he cries out for this place which was central to the faith of God's people. The place where we read in Deuteronomy was the place that God would choose as his habitation and would put his name there. That's Deuteronomy 12:5. Jesus' desire is that they would come to him and allow him to protect them from the fire of judgment. That picture, which we're in danger of thinking is cute with a mother hen, is indeed a powerful picture, but it's not actually a picture of power. You see, unlike the rooster, who I believe will defend his territory aggressively, perhaps reflecting the Messiah God's people were looking for to lead a revolution, Jesus is like the mother hen who becomes vulnerable, who gives his own life to save his people. He is the one who made himself nothing in order to become obedient to death on the cross as that once for all sacrifice for sin, to save those who will accept him as their Lord and Saviour. But what Jesus saw in Jerusalem was God's people scattering in all directions in the face of danger, running into the fire of judgment, having rejected those who had been sent to warn them of their danger of turning away from God. Those people who endeavoured to direct them back to the safety of the shadow of God's wings, and who are now in the process of rejecting the only one who could shelter and protect and deliver them from all that is evil. But we know through our reading of Revelation that judgment will come, and so despite of Jesus' compassion for the city, punishment is announced with the declaration that God would abandon the city and it would be left desolate, which probably is a reference to the destruction of Jerusalem and the temple in AD 70. You see, in these few verses, Luke gives us a strong statement about what Jesus' death is all about, which is about him standing over and taking the consequences of the fire of judgment for those who will choose to come under the protective shelter of his wings. Or to put it another way, those who will stand beneath the outstretched arms of Jesus on the cross. But rejection of this invitation comes with dreadful consequences, consequences which breaks God's heart, because without Jesus, no one can escape the inevitability of judgment, because all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God, and only the sacrifice of the perfect Saviour can save us. I guess you will have picked up that the mother hen image is not the only comparison to nature in this reading, with Jesus referring to Herod as that fox. And we might be aware of the phrase, as sly as a fox, And Herod was known for his cunning and cruelty. And we'll know also that foxes are the enemies of hens and such like. You see, that conversation with the Pharisees might come across as a bit confusing, as in other texts they come across as confrontational towards Jesus. And although they seem to be trying to help him, there's no certainty as to whether their advice is sincere or representative of a real threat, or whether they were simply trying to frighten him into moving on. And perhaps unbeknown to them, but certainly known for Jesus, that meant moving towards Jerusalem and death. Whatever the motives behind this conversation, there was that danger that Jesus could be distracted from the purpose for which he came into the world, which were, as he made clear, to cast out demons and to continue his battle with the evil one and advance the kingdom of God. As Jesus says in Luke 11:20, "But if I drive out demons by the finger of God, then the kingdom of God has come upon you." And equally, in the bringing of healing, in the most general sense of the word, including opening the eyes of the blind, both physically and spiritually, bringing freedom from sin, restoration of peace, and of course, in some instances, physical healing, all of which are part of the central purposes of Jesus' ministry. Again, as Luke makes clear, in chapter 4, verses 18 and 19, where he lays out Jesus' purposes as being to proclaim release to the captives, recovery of sight to the blind, which is again a statement about the establishment of God's kingdom. And in his conversation with the Pharisees, Jesus states that he would be doing these things today and tomorrow. Of course, these are not any indication of a measurement of time, but simply a way of emphasizing that his ministry was still ongoing. And it was he, not Herod or the Pharisees or anyone else, that would control his work or the timing of his journey to Jerusalem. The certainty was that he would use every opportunity to establish God's kingdom and to draw those who are willing into it and under his wings as he journeyed onward. But there will be a time where the work will be complete, and Jesus was journeying to that end place and that end time. Without mention of the third day, perhaps taking us to the resurrection, but we must remember that death came first. It was through the sacrificial shedding of his blood that he took our judgment and punishment, and salvation was achieved for us all, with Jesus' death as well as his life being part of his purpose of defeating all that is evil and leading to resurrection, new life, and the fullness of God's kingdom. As I've reflected on this reading, I've come to the conclusion that it raises a choice and a challenge for us as God's people today. We have the same choice to make as God's people in Jerusalem. And so we need to ask, are we fully aware of our need for Jesus? Do we come to him and allow him to hide us under his wings, so that we're protected from that final judgment, and so that we can gain the salvation won for us and all people through the death of Jesus, remembering that he leaves that choice up to individuals, to you and to me, but he gives everyone every chance to respond, but respond they must. And when we've made that choice, we need to understand that it doesn't come with a promise of a safe or easy life in this world. We know that Christians in many places, including those in Ukraine and Russia, are experiencing persecution because of their faith that leads to hardship. And equally, we're not immune to suffering, to illness and pain. But coming to Jesus does give us that assurance that his kingdom of love and peace is near, that spiritual battles are being won, and that healing in the widest sense is being experienced, even in the darkest of places. And by that I mean that people might still suffer sickness and disease. They may be living in places of conflict, but they can still know that inner peace which is beyond our understanding, that enables them to keep on going through those dark valleys and to hold on to the hope that things can be different, that God's kingdom will come, that healing and peace is possible. And of course, they can look beyond life in this world, knowing that their faith in Jesus means that they are sheltered from the fire of judgment, and that they can look forward to a new life in the fullness of God's kingdom. Last week, I was listening to the BBC Radio Leeds morning service as I was getting ready for church, and it strikes me that those themes were something that the Bishop of Europe was alluding to as he spoke at that service. And I just want to share some of those things with you. You see, he said we should be praying for peace. And while it's right to pray for a just peace, which is the absence of war, we should also be praying for that inner peace, which can be present despite the war and allows people to flourish. He also said that we, wherever we are, should keep on praying for that peace, because he said prayers were being answered as Christians have received glimmers of hope in the different things that have happened to them. And perhaps those are those things that I call God incidences, things that have happened and we can't explain why. Perhaps the other thing to remember about our position under the wings of Jesus is that's where we can be close to his heart. And that's the place where we were made to be. This is the place where we can grow to become the people God made us to be. This is the place where we can be tuned in to what is on his heart and be equipped to fulfill the purposes of God for us, which is where the challenge comes in. You see, as God's people who have received the benefits of his sacrifice, we as individuals and as a church have that responsibility to continue his work of kingdom building so that, as Jesus said, it can continue today and tomorrow and tomorrow and tomorrow. As Jesus' people, we're called to grow the kingdom of God by standing up in those spiritual battles against injustice, oppression, and inequality, and in working with God to bring others into that place of healing and peace in the widest sense, helping them to be at peace with God, themselves, and others, helping them to understand what it is to be forgiven and free from guilt and sin, helping them to have hope for the future in this life and the next, and perhaps most importantly, introducing them to the one whose kingdom we are working to grow. We might ask, how do we do this? And as in all things, this could be a sermon series on its own. But in short, it's about being available to God, to allow him to use us to fulfill his purposes. And then we need to follow Jesus' example. We need to be persistent in prayer. We need to be persistent in communicating the gospel through our words, our actions, and our attitudes, and the example of how we live our lives, which should be different from the general way of the world. All in all, holding on to the commandment of love for God and our neighbour, which very often will require sacrifice. And as we take this challenge seriously, there are things to learn from this passage from Jesus. You see, like us, Jesus was on a journey through life. He knew his goal. At this point was death in Jerusalem. But he took every opportunity to do that kingdom work, even if it meant slowing down. Whatever our goals in life, in the here and the now, or in the future, let us not be too busy or too rushed or too inflexible that we miss an opportunity to bring peace, healing, and build God's kingdom in the way that we can and in the places that God puts us. And let us not be distracted by listening to misinformation from the wrong people. Jesus had his face set to Jerusalem, where through his death, evil and death itself would be defeated, and God's kingdom would break in once and for all. And he maintained his focus as he journeyed on. He was not going to let the fear-mongering of the Pharisees set him back or put him off. Perhaps we could ask, what is it that sets us back or puts us off from those challenges or fulfilling the purposes of growing God's kingdom? Which voices do we listen to? And how do we discern between the guidance of the Holy Spirit and the distractions of the world? Perhaps as we continue our journey through Lent, that time when we traditionally do a spiritual spring clean as we move closer to the cross, we can reflect on that picture of the mother hen and the chicks, symbolizing Jesus' sacrifice, which has won for us salvation. And we can be thankful, alongside recognizing his love and care for us and all people, and deepening our relationship with him through prayer, reading scripture, and those other things that we find useful to engage with God, as well as sharing Jesus' compassion for those who reject him or simply don't know or understand his love, but who, for whatever reason, are running lost, without hope, and unaware of their way home, which is that place of peace and healing. And perhaps we need to allow ourselves to be bold, alert, and courageous in being focused on that very purpose of reaching out to them and growing God's kingdom in them as we journey together through Lent and through this world. Amen. Let's just pause to reflect and to pray. Lord our God, we just thank you for that image, that closeness that you want us to be to you. Father, we thank you for your sacrifice in order that we might be free from the fear of judgment because our sins are forgiven through you. But Father, we pray that we might hold on to that challenge, that we might be focused on growing your kingdom. Father, we pray that we might not be distracted by the things around us. Father, help us to seek your inner peace and healing for ourselves, but help us to receive it with open hands in order that we may freely give it to others that we meet day by day, but equally that we may freely pray for it for those who we might never meet. So we offer ourselves anew to you this day, and we pray that you will use us to grow your kingdom today, tomorrow, and in the days, weeks, months, and years to come, until the task is finished and your kingdom comes in all its fullness. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. We're going to stand and sing now in kind of response to those words as we ask God to guide us. Let's stand together. please do sit down as we come to our prayers of intercession. Holy Spirit, you are welcome in this place. At a time when so many voices are shouting and causing us to become anxious, we pray that we will hear your voice more clearly, Lord. We praise you for your goodness and loving kindness. We thank you for every act of kindness in our world. Thank you for our mission partners in Kenya. We pray your continued blessing on the amazing work done by the Mamusi Foundation. Please bless and protect all those children and staff, Matthew and Sally Norton, and all who work so hard for the education and well-being of the children there. We praise you, Father, for the amazing work done by our mission partners in Brazil. Again, we pray for your continued blessing on the children and the staff, and on Andre and Elena and their baby as they support this work. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. As we've mentioned, we're asked to pray for Ukraine. Our hearts are broken as we watch what is happening in Ukraine. And we know your heart is broken too, Lord. As a church family now, we pray for an end to the evil and the suffering that's happening there. We pray for all those in power, that they will be given hearts of flesh and not hearts of stone. Holy Spirit, we ask for your presence to cover the whole country of Ukraine, especially over the cities where the fighting is very bad. Lord, send your angel armies to protect the children and innocent people caught up in this war. We pray for the millions of Russians who are too afraid to speak out against this war. We ask that you will strengthen them and protect them. And we pray that the lies of the enemy will not succeed, but that truth, justice, and peace will triumph. And together we pray, your kingdom come to the country of Ukraine. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Even though the situation is so bleak, can we just spend a few minutes remembering that Jesus is Lord? And either in your hearts or out loud, if you want to say, Jesus reigns over Ukraine. The Lord reigns over Russia. The Lord reigns over every troubled heart.
Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for our church. We thank you for the gift of our church family, all of us here and those watching online. We ask that as a church, we will understand more about the cross and what it cost you to pay the price for us. We ask that the church will receive a greater blessing than it has known before, and that we can pass this blessing on to those around us and those who are seeking you. And we pray for our leaders, for David and Kathy, for Bishop Tony and Bishop Nick. We pray, Lord, you will anoint each one with wisdom and courage in these difficult times. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Finally, we pray for those known to us who are suffering or battling with illness or grief. You are the God of peace and comfort, and we pray you will bless those who are on our hearts right now. We name them before you. Merciful Father, accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen. As our Saviour taught us, so we pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
Getting my list of notices because there are quite a few. First one that I haven't written down, so I'll say it first, is that we will be having our Easter lilies at Easter, obviously. And if you wanted to buy or donate an Easter lily in remembrance of someone who you have lost recently or not so recently, then please could you see Marie at the back there, and she will take your name and she will take £1 from you as a donation towards that initiative. It's something we've not been able to do for a fair few years now because of COVID, and you know, thank God things are getting back to normal. So as I say, please see Marie at the back if you would like to be part of that. Please do remember that the Bible course is ongoing, but that it will not happen this week because this week it is Deanery Synod. So if you're on Deanery Synod, you'll be coming to that meeting. And if you're not, you'll have a week off and you'll have a bit of extra time to do your Bible readings. Giving envelopes. A few people actually give on a regular basis using little envelopes which they put in the collection plate week by week. And when it comes to kind of April time, we renew the envelopes. If you are one of those people, please would you see Liz, who is there. And she will sort you out, she promises me. Okay, so that's that. That's for later. A lot of people, we've prayed for Ukraine, and I know a lot of people are wanting to perhaps do something a little bit more practical in that, and the St. Swithin Centre are acting as a place where we can take any donations of quite specific things in order to be shipped over to the borders of Poland and Ukraine to help those who are fleeing. And it's kind of toiletries, nappies, sanitary items, medical supplies, that sort of thing. It's not food or anything like that. It's those sort of things. So if you want to donate anything, please would you, quite happy for you to bring them here, and David and I will take them to St. Swithin's, to them there, and they will deal with it. David told you about the afternoon about Tanzania, which is going to be held at St. Peter's Church in Stanley on the 20th, which is next week. And if people are interested in that, then again, if you need further information, please see one of us. And before I give the next notice, is there anything that I've forgotten? Don't think so. If you want to stay for tea and coffee, as I said, you're more than welcome, but just do it carefully. You will have heard us talking about Vision Wakefield. It was through Vision Wakefield that we were able to do the drive-in carol service a few Christmases ago during COVID. And they have a new initiative, and I have to be careful how I say it because it comes out wrong. It's a prayer app. I thought David was saying a prayer rap, which is completely would be something completely different. It is a prayer app, and it's going to be launched on Palm Sunday. But rather than me tell you about it, we've got a little bit of a promo video for you to watch.
With the prayer walking app. Here in Sheffield, we wanted to get involved with the prayer app because we wanted people to be able to visualise what was happening in the city. That although we all felt a bit isolated during lockdown, that actually you could see as the streets turned gold, other Christians, other followers of Jesus, churches across the city getting involved. We found them getting connected with their neighbours, with each other, and the Holy Spirit using them in ways we didn't expect. People were prayed for on the streets. People's faith was reinvigorated as they re-engaged with God's heart for their area.
To me, it's been a powerful experience of being able to pray over the areas that I live in so that I can have God's heart for the people that live there and serve there as well, and for my community.
I really enjoyed prayer walking because it just gave a great opportunity to go out with my boys and to be able to talk about listening to the Holy Spirit and being guided by the Holy Spirit as we're praying.
It's been quite lovely to know that as a group of people, as a group of believers, we've been covering the whole of Coventry. That's been really nice.
I've enjoyed knowing that together that we can bring the kingdom of God into our city.
I was noticing places, buildings, organizations or houses which were there, which I never knew were there. That surprised me, and it gave me opportunity to pray specifically for them.
And also I've seen it on our streets where we've prayed for things that were not going right on our streets, and God has answered and there's been transformation. So really I have prayed knowing that God is going to answer.
Greetings from Portsmouth to you in Wakefield. Just wanted to encourage you with some of the stuff we've been doing here in Portsmouth with our prayer walking. We've been running since March. We have had quite an amazing response. As an encouragement, we were given a passage, Joshua 1 verse 3. It says, every place that the sole of your foot will tread upon, I have given you, just as I promised Moses. Now, I believe that promise still applies to God's people today, whether we're in Portsmouth or whether it's with you in Wakefield, that God has given you the land. It's already been given. So we've been amazed. And also we've been so blessed with the number of churches that have joined us and the enthusiasm that people had to go out and prayer walk. And the unity that we've found that has been produced through this is amazing. And we're claiming and calling down the kingdom of God into every street in our city. Blessings to you, Wakefield, as you start your journey of prayer walking. We hope to hear the testimony of God's goodness in your city.
So I'd really encourage you to see what unity looks like by getting involved in that prayer walking app.
We're launching the app across the Wakefield district on Sunday, the 10th of April, which is Palm Sunday. You'll find the app on the Vision Wakefield website, and there are also other resources there to help you with your prayer walking.
In the launch week, there'll be various joint prayer walks around the Wakefield district, a chance for us to pray for our local communities together. More information on those will be coming out soon.
You can upload your prayer walking stories and testimonies to inspire others as they set out to engage in their own prayer walking. Let's be part of this movement and join in faith together as we cover the entire Wakefield district with our prayers.
Exciting?
Yeah.
It does involve a bit of technology, which we hope to be able to support you with. I know, Kieran, you volunteered, haven't you, to sort of help if anybody's kind of gone, oh, technology, I can't do it. I'm sure we'll be able to make it work in some way or another. And it's not just us, it's joining in with many, many churches across Wakefield. So it's a great opportunity to say, you know, we're Christians, we're together, and we're all God's body, and we're going to pray for Wakefield, and we're going to believe that God's going to honour those prayers and great things are going to happen. I'm sure there'll be lots more information coming at you. Before that, there will be an opportunity to start walking and praying on Palm Sunday, because we're going to walk from here down to the Chantry Chapel and have our service outside on Palm Sunday, hopefully. So, you know, it's a good start to start it off. So, yeah, let's pray about that and pray that we can all be involved. I think that's all as far as the notices are concerned. We're going to stand to sing our next song together, just asking God to just come and restore the honour of his name in power, in actions, in miracles. Let's pray those things as we sing together. Let's stand.
And so we receive God's blessing as we go to build that kingdom, the kingdom that will be forever and ever. So may Christ give you grace to grow in holiness, to deny yourself, to take up your cross and follow him. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with each one of you and all those who you love, care, and pray for this day and always. Amen. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord. In the name of Christ. Amen.
The chasm that lay between us, how high the mountain.